Ladies and gentlemen, a very good day to you. My name is Frederik Vos and I work for the Netherlands Ministry of Agriculture, Nature and Food Quality. And it is a pleasure for me to be your host today in this program. It's the first day of summer. It's also 1 month still to the Tokyo Olympics. And in 1 month's time, the whole world will put their attention on Japan, on Tokyo. But in advance of this, today we focus on the collaboration between the Netherlands and Japan. And we'll talk about a very modern topic, if you allow me to use those words. We'll talk about the digitalization and robotization in agriculture. How technology can enable the transition towards autonomous growing and how robots can help farmers and growers indoor and outdoor. So we'll show you some examples today of what we are doing in the Netherlands. We'll have a number of companies that present their latest products, ideas and challenges. And we also will highlight the possibilities to cooperate with Japanese partners. This program is brought to you by four partners, the Dutch Enterprise Agency, the Wageningen Agricultural University and Research Center, OostNL, which is the Regional Development Agency, and the Federation of Dutch Metal Industry Companies. So we've had already a number of webinars in the Netherlands. I'm not sure how you have experienced the last 1.5 years in Japan, but webinars have been the state of the communication in the Netherlands for the last 60 months. And if there's, we all get square eyes from watching the screen, but if there was one webinar that you really want to attend, it was this one. Unfortunately, we cannot yet meet in person, but we can make it a very interactive webinar by using the chat function, which is above in your screen. If you have a question to any of the guests or to anything you want to bring onto this table, please use the chat function and we can make it as an interactive event as if we were meeting in person. You can also send your messages in Japanese, by the way, because we are being assisted by a group of translators, and without them, this webinar would have been difficult, certainly. Now, for the opening of this webinar, I happily give the floor to the Netherlands ambassador in Tokyo, Mr. Peter van der Vliet. Mr. van der Vliet, are you there? Can you hear us? Good morning, good afternoon to you. Thank you for addressing the audience in your introductory remarks. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Frederik. It's good to see you. In fact, these days I see your name almost every day because I am currently reading your wonderful new book about Japan, which is really a must read for everybody who wants to learn more about Japan in the Netherlands. So I can certainly recommend it. Congratulations. So it's a great pleasure to welcome you all at this online event here from the embassy studio in Tokyo and to give you an opportunity to visit some companies virtually and see for yourself how the latest innovations in smart agriculture are applied in real life. And today's webinar is part of the Team NL Tokyo Expo, which is a digital platform where Dutch companies, social entrepreneurs, and knowledge institutes can meet up with their Japanese counterparts to explore possibilities for cooperation. So check out teamnltokyoexpo.com for further information. And it will have programs and content until the end of the Paralympic Games in September. So for this webinar today, I am delighted to have among our partners again, and you mentioned them already, Frederik, the East Netherlands Development Agency, OostNL, the Netherlands Enterprise Agency, RVO, world-renowned Wageningen University and Research, WURG, Food Valley, and FME. Now, there's a lot going on this week on Team NL Tokyo Expo in the field of agri and food. On Thursday, we will have a really interesting session on personalized nutrition as a driver for sports success, a very relevant subject just weeks away from the start of the Olympics. So check it out if you're interested. But first, today's event, robotics and artificial intelligence for data-driven horticulture and agriculture. Now that's quite a mouthful, quite a fascinating title. When I was a seven-year-old boy, I moved from a small city to a rural village in an agricultural region in the Netherlands for our Dutch participants, the Albasse Waard. And I moved into a house that used to be an old farmhouse. And the dairy farmer that used to live there, he moved to a new farm just a few hundred meters down the road. And what I remember from that time is that the farmer, Farmer de Jong, Boer de Jong, always walked around in his blue coveralls and was either wearing his rubber boots or, yes, really wooden shoes. And he had a tractor and some milking equipment. But that was pretty much about it, I think, in terms of technology. Now imagine, if I had asked that farmer at the time, Farmer de Jong, his thoughts on robotics and artificial intelligence for data-driven horticulture and agriculture, he would probably have looked at me and said, "Peter, what on earth are you talking about?" So my takeaway from this is not only that I am getting very old, but also that there has been a spectacular revolution in smart agriculture in a relatively short time span, a few decades. A technological revolution that is still ongoing and offers tremendous opportunities for further progress. I mean, there is probably no way that Farmer de Jong could have ever imagined a partnership by Teidi Company here in Japan, teaming up with Dutch supplier of greenhouses, Boom Group, with a offshoot of a telecom company in Japan, NTT Agro Technology, to heavily use data and artificial intelligence to optimize production. That's what agri is today. So my image of what is a farmer has changed from someone in coveralls, rubber boots, dirt on his hands, and driving a tractor, has changed radically to someone who may be an engineer or studied computer science and who uses the latest science and technology to maximize yield, efficiencies, to reduce waste and food losses, and to reduce carbon emissions. Of course, you all know this already because you are active in smart agriculture. I mean, this is your thing. In fact, many of you are driving this smart agriculture revolution. And that is great because there are many challenges still ahead around food security, for example, or sustainability. And what to think of the problem of the shrinking and aging farmer community here in Japan. So robotics, artificial intelligence, and high-tech smart agriculture in general can help deal with these issues. It's not even a choice anymore, it's a necessity to secure our future. So one thing has struck me ever since I arrived in Japan in August 2019, and that is that there is a keen interest in Japan for the track record of the Netherlands in agriculture, and an interest to learn more about it and to explore new ways to cooperate. So the ground is fertile, let's cultivate it together. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Ambassador. I mean, I announced this introductory remarks, but really yours was a keynote speech. And of course, I particularly liked the beginning of your remarks there. Well, at the table, we have a few people really driving the development that you just described. I think the cooperation in the Netherlands between academia and the private sector has always been, and the government has always been very strong. And one organization that has been in the center of that development is surely is Wageningen University. And today we have with us Marcel Zevenberger. He is a program manager agri-food at the One Planet Research Center in Wageningen. Marcel, welcome. Thank you for joining us at the table.
Thank you.
Your organization is already very active in Japan, I believe.
Yeah, that is true. So One Planet was established 2 years ago, so we're relatively new in this field. So I'm working for IMEC, which is a big technology R&D center. And for the last 35 years, we have driven, you know, the semiconductor industry. All the technology that you see here around you has key ingredients that originate from our institute. And in that field, we have worked already for many years with established partners in Japan. And now we are also exploring how can we use this nanotechnology and digital technology, so very disruptive solutions in the agri-tech sector.
Yeah, I think we have a video ready that shows what you're doing. So we will show the One Planet Research Center in Wageningen in a short video.
Welcome here at the test field of Wageningen University in the Netherlands. Here tests are performed in different plots among the campus for research at different crops. I'm a researcher of One Planet. Behind me you can see the ridges in which the potatoes are grown. With electrical impedance tomography we measure on a very fine grid the electrical impedance of the ground for imaging the potatoes while they're growing in the ground. Impedance measurements are already known in agriculture. And with using different algorithms to extract information about the grow of the potatoes and the root structures. They tell a lot about the health of the plant. By monitoring the plants more closely, you can adjust the amount of watering and fertilizing more precisely. Because the number of people on the planet is growing and growing, we need to get more yield out of our fields. And on the other hand, we need to reduce the amount of pollution, like nitrogen.
That was clear, Marcel, because this is also the project that we saw is being conducted together with Japanese partners.
Correct,
right?
yes.
And you think working together with the Japanese companies and organizations is really beneficial to the both of you?
Yeah, definitely. Like within One Planet, we really try to bridge these two different fields, the high-tech sector and the agriculture sector. And we're becoming now a hub where those two domains are meeting. And we see companies in our networks, you know, reaching out to each other, Japanese companies, get to be introduced into the agri-tech sector via an organization like One Planet.
Yeah. It's a particular that this development is so strong in the agricultural sector. And I think we have another clear example at the table here with Mr. Arno Stienen, who is the business unit manager of a company called Demcon. And Mr. Stienen is in the agri-food systems because particularly the drive for digitalization and robotization takes place in agriculture. And maybe, Mr. Stienen, if you agree, we also have a video of your company and introduce your company to the audience by showing the video. Please.
We are Demcon, a high-end technology supplier. Operating from several locations worldwide, we develop, realize, test and produce high-end technology and innovative products. We are capable of developing complex systems for a wide variety of markets. We view our clients as partners and work closely together with them on bringing their vision to reality. Our engineers facilitate everything from concept design to the production of a custom end product. In our high-tech environment, multidisciplinary teams with great technological capabilities allow for a wide variety of projects.
Yeah, I think that was very clear. Mr. Steene, can you explain us a little bit, what is exactly driving the robotization in agriculture?
I think there's a couple of reasons for that. On the one hand, the remarks that the ambassador made, food security, sustainability requires a different approach to what we've been doing so far. If you look at the challenges many people have in getting both workers into the greenhouses or into the agriculture, and on the other hand, also maintaining a high level of knowledge about what you need to do to actually grow the crops at the maximum rate, it requires the introduction of technology. Therefore, it's from a needs perspective in the market, there's a need for the robotization and for the AI. On the other hand, you also see on the robotic side that steps have been made that make it easier. Up until recently, most robots were programmed to do endpoint tasks directly. But in recent years, we've seen a lot of development where robots can actually learn from demonstrations done by humans, or where robots learn each time when they perform a task, they can self-evaluate, was that correct or not? And then they can modify the strategy the next time around. So those developments from a robotic side also makes it easier to implement it in a very challenging environment that is agriculture.
So where do you think then in, say, 5 years, 5 years from now, where will the industry be? How far will the robotization have gone in 5 years?
I think we've already taken a lot of really good steps. If you look at greenhouses, for instance, the logistics from getting the tomato out of the path all the way to the sorting center, and then all the way to the auction houses, and then worldwide distribution, a lot of that has been automated or semi-automated already. It's now the final steps that we are seeing, where you actually have to get the vegetables or the fruits from the trees or from the plants onto the logistics systems. So I think within the next 5 years, we will see some very exciting and actually working implementations of these robots, where the early adopters can make a difference in their sector.
And for you, Marcel, what is your opinion about where we'll be in 5 years?
Well, I think within 3 to 5 years, indeed, we start to see the introduction of new robots. And these robots will also feed, for instance, all kinds of new, call it augmented reality or decision support systems. As for instance, also the ambassador, the grower, all his knowledge that will be, you know, that is in his hedge, will be captured hopefully and translated into support systems that for instance help growers take informed decision based on data that is being captured from the greenhouse, from the robots, about plant health, yield, etc. I think we'll see a big revolution there in the coming years.
Where do you think this innovation will be the strongest? Is it will be in academia, in institutes like yourself, or is maybe more like the private sector leading this development?
We need both. We really need both. We as an R&D, we are really, you know, at the beginning of the innovation chain. We really want to focus on the unmet needs, the really big challenges that robots cannot handle yet. All kinds of new imaging or radar technology to image fruit, to assess fruit quality, that sort of things that are not yet can be done real time. Those are the big challenges that we would like to focus. But if successful, we need the supply and other innovators also to bring that to market, to make sure that it is implemented with the right form factor requirements, etc.
Yeah, because driving things to the market, you have a hub in Singapore, I believe, Mr. Steene. The interaction with your partners in Asia, is that an important element in your innovation development?
Absolutely. That's why we opened that hub now a couple of years ago to really get closer ties to our potential customers over there. And it is absolutely the interaction. We come from a technology background. We have a fairly high level of technological competence. But it's actually the partners, the customers in the domains themselves who bringing so much valuable knowledge. So from us here to imagine what's like what a customer in Japan or in Singapore needs is crazy. We need to have the close weekly interactions with those customers to actually fully understand what their needs are and for us to be able to provide the best possible technologies to actually resolve those needs.
Yeah, and you have contacts with Japan from Singapore, or is this webinar the most brilliant opportunity for you?
It's a good opportunity in AgriFood. I think this is the first opportunity for us to present ourselves to Japan, although we have spoken to a couple of Japanese companies so far, of course. I can't reveal too many details there.
Yeah. So there's one company that already, there's of course many companies that work together from Japan and the Netherlands. And there's not so long ago, there was a joint venture in the Netherlands that attracted quite a bit of attention between a greenhouse company called Certon and Denso, which is famous for its robots. This is a kind of cooperation that will, of course, will, you know, when you mix the knowledge and the competences of those two companies, can have wonderful results. We can also show you a video of the ISO group in the Netherlands where these robots are being used. And the ISO group uses the machines of Denso, but it's another great example. We show you in a short video.
Wat wij als ISO groep doen is machines ontwikkelen die de kweker helpen om arbeidsintensieve en veel repeterende taken te automatiseren. De machines die wij produceren bestaan voornamelijk uit drie kerntaken. Dat is de vision technologie, de plant handling van de plant en de inzet van robots. De robots die wij gebruiken komen van de firma Denso. Dat is een Japanse maatschappij. Die robots gebruiken wij omdat zij erg betrouwbaar zijn en van een hoge kwaliteit. De taken die wij automatiseren binnen de tuinbouwsector beperken zich niet alleen tot het steken van stekken. Maar wat wij bijvoorbeeld ook doen is het enten van jonge groenteplanten, het planten van tulpenbollen, maar ook het knippen van jonge rozenstek. Binnen ISO Groep kijken wij niet alleen naar de Nederlandse markt, waarin de vraag naar automatisering heel hoog is. Wij zien ook internationaal dat er steeds meer vraag is naar onze machines. Zo exporteren wij onze machines onder andere naar Amerika, naar Oceanië, maar ook naar Azië. Zo staan er bijvoorbeeld ook machines in Japan. In Japan hebben wij een bedrijf dat ons helpt met het verkennen van de Japanse markt. De Japanse markt is toch echt anders als de Nederlandse markt. Deze Japanse partner maakt eigenlijk de vertaalslag van onze machines naar de Japanse markt. Zo helpen zij ons bij het installeren en ook bij het vinden van nieuwe klanten op het gebied van enten, maar ook op het gebied van steksteken. Wij zien binnen de tuinbouwsector eigenlijk een verregaande groei en vraag naar automatisering. Door onder andere de vergrijzing en door het seizoensmatige werk van de tuinbouwsector. Ook wij ontwikkelen ons verder op het gebied van plant handling, op het gebied van vision technieken en op het gebied van robotisering. En wij hopen eigenlijk als ISO groep de tuinder zowel nu als in de toekomst verder te kunnen helpen met automatisering. Zowel in Nederland, maar ook in het buitenland. En een mooi voorbeeld denk ik is ook Japan.
Yes, so that was an example of how robots can be used in the greenhouse and also of the Japanese knowledge that is being used in the Netherlands. We saw an example that was basically coming from the car factories like the Denso machines. One last question, Mr. Steene, and a brief answer if possible. Like what will be the drive in automatization in agriculture? Is that something that now will come from, for example, robots developed in car factories, or is the development in agriculture strong enough to drive the future?
They are quite different, the robots that you need in a car factory and in agriculture. That's why there are no robots yet in agriculture, at least not on a large commercial scale. So I think the robots will be new, but we can learn a lot from the car industry, both in how they implemented the technology which was available in the 80s, but also in how they actually make cars in a reliable and cheap way. We also need to think about robots as a mass product, and we need to implement their production knowledge to actually create these robots.
Yeah, and for you, Mr. Zevenberger, mm-hmm. the use of data, as we saw in the video, mm-hmm. that will be something that is managed from institutes like yourself.
Yeah, I think from institutes like One Planet, huh, we want to create. You know what. If you mix and the new sensor technologies and these new data algorithms, it you need them both. You need, you know, the good and data that will feed these algorithms. And I think that's where in an institute like One Planet where you can get and meet best of both worlds.
Okay, well, thank you. I think this kind of concludes the session we had. Thank you very much for being here, and good luck with your business. And I hope also in cooperation with Japanese partners and Japanese organizations. Thank you very much for being here. And then we turn to the first part of this webinar that concerns the indoor growing. The second part will be outdoor production, but we'll start with indoor. And a very new greenhouse that is really worth looking at is is found in the Netherlands Plant Eco-Phenotyping Center, also located in Wageningen. And to introduce that to you, we have a short video that will explain what is happening in this center.
We zijn hier midden in de KAS, de nieuwe KAS van Wageningen University and Research, op de campus in Nederland. En dit is een fenotyperingskas. Dus hier staat eigenlijk, ja, kijk om je heen, de planten staan centraal om gemeten te worden hoe ze opgroeien. Er is een project dat heet TADA, Transition Towards a Data-Driven Agriculture. Daarin zijn wij aan het samenwerken met Japanse partners, onder andere NTT, Kubota en het onderzoeksinstituut NARO. En dat is zo'n voorbeeld van een internationaal samenwerkingsproject die ook gebruik maakt van de tools die we hier om ons heen zien. Dus in dit geval de veldapparatuur, het voertuig en de drones. Ja, dus we zijn hier in het compartiment waar de sensor naar de plant beweegt. En dan scant hij eigenlijk de plant. En we hebben ook hier een compartiment zo optimaal mogelijk gemaakt met daglichtschermen, met aanvullend LED-verlichting, met een hele goede regulering van de luchtcirculatie. En uiteindelijk is de essentie dat je meet hoe de plant groeit. Hier gaat de sensor naar de plant toe. En hier achter mij dan gaan de planten juist naar de sensor toe. Die meten hoe de plant groeit. Die verschillende camera's verzamelen data. En al die data die wordt opgestuurd naar een cloud, waar één experiment dan als een databundel wordt aangeboden aan de eindgebruiker. En dan moet je echt denken aan terabytes aan data per project.
Naast het meten aan planten met die fenotypering doen wij bij Wageningen ook heel veel onderzoek aan automatisering en robotica. En al de technieken en methodes die wij bij het fenotyperen gebruiken, ja, die hebben we ook nodig om automatische gewashandelingen te gaan doen. Projecten die wij doen op het gebied van robotica, die richten zich bijvoorbeeld op het automatisch oogsten van glasgroenten, zoals komkommers of paprika. En we hebben ook projecten in het open veld voor selectieve oogst van broccoli of het oogsten van appels. Nou, dit zijn vaak projecten die heel complex zijn, waar je heel veel verschillende disciplines en modules nodig hebt. Het gaat over sensoren, het gaat over robots die moeten bewegen. Het gaat over de intelligentie die daarin zit. En daarom doen wij dit soort projecten heel vaak samen met een grote consortium. Vaak samen met bedrijfsleven, samen met telers die precies weten waar het probleem zit. En dat doen we ook vaak in internationaal verband.
Ik zie een toekomst vormen waarin de kassen volledig onbemand werken, waarbij meetapparatuur zoals hier ronddraaien en waar robots aan het oogsten zijn. Allemaal om zo om vers en gezond voedsel te maken voor de groeiende wereldbevolking.
So that showed a little bit of the latest when it comes to eco-phenotyping in the Netherlands. We are joined here in the studio with four knowledgeable guests who can explain about what is happening in indoor growing. We have with us Mr. Marco van Schrieken of a company called Keygene, very much also active in phenotyping and breeding. We have with us Angela Barendrecht, who works for Hogendoorn International Growth Management. Welcome to you, Mr. Richard Vialle, who works for Kind Technology. He is the CCO and founder. And we have with us Mr. Takehito Shimizu, who is the managing director of Inaho, and Inaho Europe, I should say, because you're located in the Netherlands. So very welcome to the four of you. Mr. van Schrieken, we start with you because we saw in the video some examples of how phenotyping is driving the breeding industry, and your company is very, very active in that field, and if I may say so, world famous also for what you're doing. Can you explain a little bit what is your company's goals and what is the objectives of your company?
Well, thank you. The setup for our company is to assist the breeding companies in order to produce the best varieties, the best genotypes, so that we have optimal production inside of the greenhouse. And as such, these also need to collaborate with these upcoming robotic technologies. So the phenotyping, as explained a minute ago, is being done at our company for about 10 years already by now.
Because I learned your company was also active in the what we had in Holland, the Anonymous Greenhouse Challenge.
Yeah.
So how do you work together with other companies to achieve an Anonymous Greenhouse?
Yeah, so the Autonomous Greenhouse Challenge is a challenge where you are able to see if you're able to grow a complete crop using computer vision or AI technology already. And in that case, we collaborated with a number of partner companies to try and execute that the last year. And that's been very successful already. So now it's the aim to try and scale that up towards the actual application in the growers market, yes.
Yeah, it would have been nice if we could have visited your company this morning, but we do have a short video that explains a little bit what your company does and what is the philosophy of your company, Keygene. A short video.
Keygene is een researchbedrijf. En Keygene is een bedrijf wat via R&D op het gebied van moleculaire veredeling, DNA-technologie, inzage in hoe DNA eruit ziet, DNA van gewassen. Op basis daarvan ontwikkelen we allerlei technieken en procedures die het onze klanten, en dat is de zaadveredelingsindustrie, het mogelijk maakt om betere gewassen te ontwikkelen. Dat betreft bijvoorbeeld dan eigenschappen als bijvoorbeeld resistenties tegen ziekten en plagen, om daarmee het gebruik van bijvoorbeeld chemicaliën te reduceren. Of bijvoorbeeld droogteresistente planten, waarbij je dus kunt voorbereiden op de klimaatverandering die nu gaande is. En zo hebben we dus een aantal sustainability, maar ook een aantal climate resilience doelstellingen in ons onderzoek. Ja, op dit moment wordt bijna alle natuurlijke rubber wordt vanuit de rubberbomen geproduceerd. Die worden geteeld. Grote plantages in Zuidoost-Azië en daar wordt oerwoud voor gekapt op onder andere Borneo. En dat willen we natuurlijk niet. De laatste oerwouden willen we daar behouden. En daarom wordt er kortzachtig gezocht naar een alternatief gewas om daarmee natuurlijke rubber te kunnen produceren. Nou, een mooi voorbeeld van een nieuw gewas dat we aan het ontwikkelen zijn met nieuwe eigenschappen betreft de paardenbloem. Paardenbloemen in Kazachstan zijn hele kleine plantjes. Die hebben het vermogen om een latex te produceren in de wortels waar je een hele goede rubber van kan maken. De Nederlandse paardenbloem heeft dat niet. En wat we nu gedaan hebben is dat we de Nederlandse paardenbloem met de Russische paardenbloem, Kazachstaanse paardenbloem, gekruist hebben. En dan krijg je dus hele sterke planten. En die planten hebben dus het vermogen om een hele hoge kwaliteit latex te maken waar je een hele hoge kwaliteit natuurlijke rubber van kan produceren. Voor de bandenindustrie, voor de fietsbandenindustrie en allerlei andere applicaties.
Een ander voorbeeld waar we bij Kijin aan werken is virusresistentie. Dus er zijn best veel plantenvirussen die via insecten, zoals bijvoorbeeld witte vlieg, verspreid worden. En door klimaatverandering zien we dat die witte vlieg op steeds meer plekken voorkomt. Nou, we kijken bij Kijin dus ook en hoe we een plant weerbaarder kunnen maken tegen insecten. Maar ook hoe we ervoor kunnen zorgen dat het virus wat die insecten meebrengen niet de plantencel binnen kan dringen. Een voorbeeld daarvan is Gemini-virus in peper- en paprikaplanten. En daarvoor hebben we dus een gen gevonden wat aangepast kan worden, waardoor dat virus de plant niet meer binnen kan dringen. En een bijkomend voordeel is dat we dan ook niet meer hoeven te spuiten tegen de witte vlieg zelf, tegen degene die het virus verspreidt.
Het ontwikkelen van doorbraakinnovaties vergt samenwerking, internationale samenwerking, ook samenwerking tussen Nederlandse bedrijven en Japanse bedrijven. En in dat kader zijn we ook heel erg geïnteresseerd in het ontwikkelen van nieuwe gewassen om daarmee plantaardige eiwitten te kunnen produceren in het kader van de eiwittransitie.
So that explains, I think, rather well what Kijin is doing. So the data-driven growing in greenhouses, how far is that going to? How far can you go? What is the end?
I think the end is not in sight yet. I think it can revolutionize the growing industry as a whole, and we are at the forefront of that. And it's only just starting, I think. So there's much to come yet.
So, Mr. Van Thune, your CEO in the video referred to working together with the Japanese partners. Is that already taking place?
Absolutely. One of our shareholder companies is a Japanese breeding company. So from that point of view, we are working with Japan and Taki already for many, many years, with the aim to aid those the breeding itself, and from there on to make the best genetic genotypes.
And you're open for further, although you're one of your shareholders is Japanese, you're open to do operations with other companies as well?
Oh, absolutely. I think we're in terms of the collaboration is where we will find the added value for the setup to come.
Thank you. So we turn to the company Hogendoorn, because I already mentioned the Anonymous Greenhouse Challenge, and your company is also very active in that field. So what is data-driven production in the greenhouse? What does it mean to you?
Yes, thank you for the introduction. Indeed, we were part of the winning team of the Autonomous Greenhouse Challenge of the Wageningen University in 2020 as well. And we are very active in the field of data-driven growing. In practice, we autonomize climate and irrigation control for many growers around the world already. We are active in more than 95 countries in order to provide process control with our new process computer, the IVO, introduced in October 2020.
So, to what extent is the use of robots in a greenhouse, to what extent does it make them more profitable? Is a question that just came in through the chat.
Yes, I think if we increase the return of investment of robots by increasing their harvest speed, but also the harvesting quality, there will be a lot of return of investment for growers worldwide. But we are not there yet already.
But you find in Japan that because of the aging society and the also the cost of production, that it is a welcoming market for such a development?
Yes, indeed. In Japan, they should be very efficient with a labor source, and green thinkers are decreasing as well. So data-driven growing in combination with robotics is essential.
So I think also for Hogendoorn, we have a video to introduce what the company is doing, and maybe we can have a look at this, your video, to get a better idea.
Would be wonderful.
What if there's a system that speaks the same language as crops and plants, that understands nature and connects to everything? It's time to grow smarter, to do more with less. It's time to analyze and improve. It's time to meet the future. Ready, set, grow.
That's a very dynamic video.
Yes, indeed. This is our new revolutionary IVO process computer. Yeah. It's an evolution for the process computer because it's ready for autonomous growing.
It's ready for autonomous growing?
Yes, indeed.
So so you think the future is there? I mean, that would be the final objective, right, of the robotization of the greenhouse production?
I think so, but I think we also need employees still in the future. But employees will get another function, such as data scientists or mechanical engineers, because IE models do not act regarding unexpected events, such as a burst in a water pipe. The IE models does not take into account these events.
Yeah, it would take farming to a complete new level. Huh? I mean, yes. As the ambassador already said also in his introduction, I mean, if that would happen, then agriculture would be a science that is unbelievable for those of a previous generation.
Unstoppable and sustainable as well, if we base it on the plant empowerment principles and put the plant first.
Put the plant first.
Yes.
And you do so with the Japanese partners.
Yes, we do, and also with the Japanese growers, such as the SARA project in Japan, very sustainable project with the biomass central, and we connected also the biomass to the process computer, so everything acts in the same manner.
That's what you call progress, right?
Yes, yeah. Indeed.
We have another guest at the table that I would like to introduce, Mr. Richard Vialle of Kind Technologies. You're active in the same field.
Absolutely, we are active in horticulture with computer vision, robotics, data, and AI. So we automate the greenhouse and the pack house from a logistics and handling perspective.
And that too is the use of artificial intelligence is making the world look different.
Absolutely, because of the waste that is currently in the process of the manual process, we believe that with AI algorithms, we can reduce giveaway weight, reduce waste in general, and increase the yield per square meter. So in essence, we believe that you can get much more profitable and healthy food out of a square meter than we currently do in the traditional way.
So here too is the question, like, what is the benefits for the grower? I mean, he would need an investment company behind him to realize this kind of production, or is that?
Well, not necessarily. Obviously, the return on investment should be okay, but the real benefit is less employees, and at the end of the day, we have a scarcity of labor, of course. Less people in the greenhouse is also less spread of virus. The benefits is more yield per square meter, and also more controlled yield. So instead of selling a product on a daily basis, it can already be predicted to sell the product, cucumbers, tomatoes, in advance at the highest price. And so at the end of the day, much more scalability, flexibility, and efficiency.
Yeah, so maybe we have to turn to a company like Keygene again, because if you listen to this kind of technological development, I mean, you can't grow the crops that you always used to grow. You have to adapt the crops to make them more easier, adaptable to such a greenhouse, right?
Yeah, this is absolutely the case, and it has been for many years, but it's still many years to come. So how open is a crop? How fast does it grow? And how even does it produce these fruits? How resistant is it already to these viruses? These are all traits which are dedicated and specific to each and every of these plants. So every variety which we help produce, try to improve that just a little bit in order to move towards this automated growing principle.
Yeah, there's a question that came in through the chat is, to what extent is the European position on CRISPR-Cas breeding technology, to what extent is that affecting your business?
Well, the CRISPR-Cas technology allows you to evaluate gene function very efficiently, but that's not specifically needed in order to improve varieties. We already know how to breed and to improve them. So CRISPR-Cas is used in fundamental science, but not so much in application in the daily growing as such.
So even if the regulations do not change, which I personally cannot imagine, but you will stay a Dutch company, you will not flee to countries that...
We will not flee to countries, indeed. We have the know-how already in-house, but we do follow and monitor the rulings of the Brussels EU Commission very closely, yes.
Of course. What else can you say? Richard, I'd like to, because we already briefly touched upon what your company is doing, but also to introduce it to the audience in Japan, I think we should take a look at a small video about what your company is doing.
Yes, and I will also give some background. Here you see the Plantalizer, which is a yield predicting robot passing through the greenhouse at night. So this is with our joint venture Hortilogix that we have together with Royal Brinkman and Berg Automotive. It scans the tomato. And next step is our harvesting robot, which we developed in a prototype phase currently at, in this case, cucumbers. It automatically, dynamically chooses the path to the crops without damaging the crops. And it only selects the right class cucumbers. So the waste is going down and you can sell it in advance because the vision on the robot also sees the cucumbers that are not yet ready yet. Then if you transport the products to the pack house, what you see here is our award-winning sorting pack, which is robots that combine the classification, grading, sorting and packing in once. So the individual data of each tomato is available. So it can be traced back to the row out of the greenhouse, but also towards the customer from a track and tracing perspective.
And that includes the traceability of the product.
Absolutely. We know exactly which tomato came out of which greenhouse, but also in which box it went to what pallet to what customer. Images are made as well to protect the quality, but then you have full track and tracing in the value chain. Also later on towards the retailer and the consumer.
So obviously those kind of elements are also hugely important for the Japanese market. Are you already active in Japan? Are you work together with Japanese partners?
We are not yet. We are very much focused on US and Europe to date, but we are very much interested due to the aging facilities in Japan, but also the growing interest in healthy food. So we are looking really forward to partner and to work with Japanese companies.
So this development, you don't start from scratch. When you further innovate, you always jump from the existing situation to a thing you have imagined. It's not because there was a question in the chat about whether it is not too costly. I think many people that are watching have a concern about the cost of such a development.
Well, I mean, obviously, if we develop something, we always take that into account. Otherwise, we wouldn't have a future. So the return on investment of this kind of technology is there. It's very interesting. Bear in mind that labor scarcity is a bigger problem. Labor cost is growing as well. So it only gets better from a profitability case. Besides the return on investment purely on labor cost, you then get all the extra benefits because the cameras on these robots can also be used for phenotyping. So you get new revenue streams from breeders. The prediction of the yield is really limiting the risk of investors, greenhouse growers, and optimizing the yield. I mean, you can sell the cucumbers 3 days ahead at the highest price. So it's generating value on top of cost savings as well.
So it would lead to think that the organizations or the companies that you deal with are not traditional growers.
Well, they are in many sense. I mean, a lot of Dutch growers are at the front end and they want to get more out of the square meters. But also internationally, we work with traditional growers that find it hard to find good personnel and who want to grow. And then the only way to grow is automation. The next type of customers that we see now are investors. So indeed, the landscape is changing. Where it used to be growers only, now you see investors stepping into new greenhouse projects. And these companies want to reduce their risk and they want to have data-driven greenhouses. And we give them the tools to limit their risk and to influence their yields. So yes, traditional growers, but a changing landscape there as well.
Because that will be the experience of a company like Hogendoorn as well, I think. You deal with different entities.
Yes, we deal with a lot of different entities, and we also see the investment market with the lessening of green fingers around the world. So we really believe in solutions such as the Plantalizer, in which we are collaboration through Let's Grow.com, to improve the quality of the crop, but also to improve the labor force, improve the sustainability of a greenhouse. It's an add-on on many types of ways.
So, Richard, so I joked a little bit with Ms. Barendrecht about that the future has arrived, that we have reached an autonomous greenhouse. But what are, in your view, still the challenges remaining? What remains to be done?
I think at the end of the day, it's no rocket science, but it's still a lot of work to do. And it's also about the acceptation of the growers. They are very conservative. They first want to see it. I mean, bear in mind that in automotive, if the robot doesn't work, okay. But if in the greenhouse, if the robot doesn't work, they have a big issue because the cucumber, the tomato continues to grow. So it's the adoption of the market, it's the whole exception, and also the change of the process. Because if you go to automation, robotization, you also need to scale up to 24/7 processing, your logistics, your buffering. So I would say we still need 3 to 5 years to really get into that controlled greenhouse environment. And then again, let's say 5 to 10 years to a fully autonomous greenhouse without people.
Yeah, and so a question that maybe for the both of you that came in via the chat is whether a greenhouse needs to be adapted. If you move into robotization, do you certainly need a different premises, or how do you have to change the layout of your company?
It's a bit of a chicken and an egg story. I believe that in this phase, we need to adapt our robotics to the existing greenhouses. And then when it's proven technology, I see the greenhouse concept change as well, adapting to the robotics, longer lanes and different logistics solutions. But at this stage, we still need to prove and get the market acceptance. And then later on, new ideas and new concepts will arrive.
And thereafter, you have to have chain collaboration through the whole production chain to have an autonomous greenhouse that functions as a complete solution. So solution as a service, everything needs to connect. Every robot needs to connect to a data platform. Every sensor needs to connect to the same data platform to function as a whole.
Right. Well, I think the success of your companies shows that the Netherlands is quite advanced and very much very active in driving this development. We have also Mr. Shimizu at the table, who works for Inaho, a Japanese company. Welcome at the table to you also, sir, because you have set up your operations in the Netherlands because you thought this was the powerhouse in horticulture.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, like you mentioned, the people are very keen to look at this picture at the automatic operation in the greenhouse. That's why we start our operation in the Netherlands. Well, we are still very new to this industry, but people are very open to discuss any possible collaboration. And although each company has its own interest, I see people all working together to make it happen. So, and unfortunately, we are still an early stage startup with limited resources in many aspects. So if we can work together with the people in the Netherlands, we can still achieve our goal and that's very important for us. So that's why we are here today.
Yeah, of course, we don't want to, I mean, your company has obviously invested a lot to be connected to the Dutch market. Do you think that that there is more room for collaboration between Japanese partners and Dutch companies?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, because we develop our robot in Japan, and I think we have a very advanced technology in our robot. So we develop our tomato harvesting robot in Japan, and we plan to bring it to the Netherlands once we complete the current update, and because we have a field trial in Japan right now. So
I think we can already, we have a video, right?
Yes.
Of the tomato harvester. It's a very cool film, and I think we should have a look at the video of Inaho and the tomato harvester. Thank you. A day, whereas in the greenhouse, of course, with the manual labor, you face all kinds of other challenges.
Well, yeah, this video is from our latest field trial in Japan, and yeah, we just started large-scale field trial last month, and we are, yeah, this trial, we are still developing our robot's performance, including harvest speed, harvest rate, so we have many challenges in everything. In the regards of everything of the robot, and yeah, we are also quantifying how much benefit we can bring it to the grower, because we work this project with a grower in Japan. So once we complete the update and get the certain result of the field trial, we plan to bring it to the Netherlands direct to carry out the field trial in the Netherlands as well. So we are now seeking a partner who can work for it with us in the Netherlands. And actually, we've been discussing it with several companies in the Netherlands as well. Yeah, that's the current status for us now. And yeah.
Because when you use this kind of a product, I can also imagine that you attract a whole new variety of entrepreneurs to the farming sector. When it is such a high-tech, advanced robot system, it's not a traditional farmer anymore. Wants to grow tomatoes.
Yeah, so yeah, in Japan, some of the growers are looking at their future farming, including their automatic operation in the greenhouse. So we work together with that kind of grower, and we work together with them to develop their this kind of technologies together, and yeah, so.
So, and when you look at these robot development, you can create the ultimate sustainability of the production. One element that is that came in through the chat is the nutrient use efficiency. But that's is that something that through AI I can imagine you can you can grow varieties which make optimum use of nutrients.
Yeah, that's exactly the case. You can see already in these different movies which came along. In the end, you're interacting with the crop. So the crop itself is central, and that is a continuous improvement as well. So there's a both way technology. So the robots need to adapt to the crop, but the crop also towards the robots. How easy these fruits come loose, how easy they are accessible, how is their nutrient use efficiency of these crops, that makes a dramatic difference in terms of the profitability for the grower.
Yeah, because I can imagine the greenhouse becomes, there's a lot of talk in the government about sustainable development goals, but the greenhouse, the horticultural sector, it has so many crossover benefits to other sectors of the economy. I can imagine that when you have it automated the production, that it becomes so attractive to reach your sustainable development goals by promoting horticulture. Is it not?
It does.
I mean, your comment first.
I think in horticulture, it's all about reducing the waste. I mean, I think that only 1/3 of the product arrives at the plate at the end of the day. So if we can take that away and use less pesticide and get more organic products out there, healthier food, it will drive up sustainability and profits at the same time. And with this robotics AI combined and with the controlling environment, we can really get there. We can get much more out of the square meter with less pressure on the food, less footprint, and less pressure on the planet.
Yeah. So sustainability. Well, we know in the Netherlands is really talk of the day. I guess in Japan it would not be much different. What exactly, Mr. Shimizu? I turn to you again. What do you think is the thing that the Japanese market or the Japanese horticultural sector needs most to advance or to be at the place where it wants to be?
I think the most important issue would be Now the market is very fragmented in Japan. So for example, I think 90% of the farmers and individual farmers, but if you look at the Netherlands, yeah, it's very centralized, like a big, there is a big company producing the many crops, and yeah, it's very centralized, and everything is very, you know, practical and convenient in that way. It's like it's very commercialized, I would say. So yeah, this kind of transformation will be necessary for Japanese market, I guess. Yeah, I think that's important.
And that's
if you consider the if you consider a sustainable way for the farming, we also need to look at the commercial efficiency and the commercial side.
Hmm, I understand. When you look at one question also that came to the chat, Ms. Barendrecht, maybe I can ask you, van the span of control that a grower has in your in a greenhouse that has been fully equipped with your innovations. What is the span of control for an individual grower? How large can you think of a greenhouse when all is said and done?
Yes, in the world you see that the greenhouse facilities will become larger and larger, and you see that growers can make decisions based on objective data, but also based on the images of the cameras or the robotics, and then the growers can handle and make decisions for multiple locations at the same time. So if you have a greenhouse with multiple locations, you can manage it with one or two growers and not flying over the world with crop advisors. It's very, very efficient in this manner.
And in the end, it will be done from within your company even.
Yes. We also have a demonstration center in the Tomato World in the Netherlands, where we manage the crop and cultivation from our office based on data-driven growing.
If you saw our video, if you take 10 hectares of cucumbers, you currently need 120 people. We made simulations that if you go with our robotics, it can be reduced easily to 20. If you then take things like the plantalizer, the yield prediction is now very often done by spreadsheets. It's not very accurate. If you can automate that by a plantalizer and AI, it will be drastically better. So you can do it with even less people and really can increase the yield per square meter. So I think the span of control will be different, which allows growers to either grow or to do or work with a designated group on a specific niche.
And you, the 20 persons you need, are they, let's say, traditional labor, or are they more like software engineers?
No, it's a mixture. I mean, first of all, we believe that we will always need people in the first phase, because the robot, there will be situations that the robot cannot pick the cucumber, the tomato, the pepper. So you will still need a small group of designated specialists picking those really difficult positions, which is not so hard because you know where they are due to the whole scanning. And then indeed you will see a change in the staff of also more highly educated people managing the robots, working with the data, and making sure that the process control is up to date.
You know, I work in the Ministry of Agriculture, really, and we talk a lot about sustainability and robots, but when I listen to you here in the room, then I really feel that there's so much going on and there's so much development. It's really amazing. So our time is kind of is up. So I have to thank you for your presence here. But I think really very inspiring session to have you here. And really, you know, as Inao is experiencing, the Netherlands is a powerhouse in horticulture. But with people like you, and that I include you, Mr. Shimizu, I think this we can do a lot still. So thank you very much for being here, and good luck in creating that autonomous greenhouse with the desired plants and the contacts abroad, in particular Japan. Ladies and gentlemen, we in the next part of this webinar, we turn to the challenges relating to outdoor growing. In the meanwhile, we'll when we invite our new guests on, we will show you a brief video about the Agro Food Robotics that is in located in Wageningen University and Research Center. And that also shows elements of Hogendoorn and other companies. So we start that video right now, and we'll be with you in 5 minutes again.
Life is all about balance. For instance, the perfect balance of sunlight, water, temperature, and human care to let healthy and safe vegetables grow. With state-of-the-art high-tech developments, Dutch horticulture is empowered to protect this balance as never before. Today, we use substrates, computer-steered climate-controlled, and recirculating systems. Bumblebees for pollination and insects and mites for pest control. Plants are made highly productive and resistant for diseases, which means less chemicals are needed. Our energy efficiency is almost 90%. But we're not there yet. The world population keeps growing. Not everyone has access to a daily portion of vegetables. We believe that new technologies are revolutionary in providing fresh and healthy vegetables to all people in a sustainable way. That's why we keep exploring. With robots, data, artificial intelligence, genetics, and biology, Dutch horticulture becomes a more and more efficient industry. In the future, plants are made fit for robotic harvesting, and researchers find ways to fully replace what's left of the labor force. Local genetics are used for local products, which gives us better possibilities for nutrition, taste, and convenience. Ecological production and the reuse of materials helps us to save resources and maintain a minimum of waste in the production chain. The perfect balance between technology, genetics, and biology can make the difference in producing sufficient and safe fresh vegetables. This leads to our most important goal, providing access to qualitative fresh vegetables to consumers worldwide, everywhere, anytime. We're ready for it. What about you?
So welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. And this is the second part of our webinar. And this time we will dedicate our the conversation and the videos to the challenges of outdoor growing, robotics and artificial intelligence. I'm joined at the table with four other persons and all experts in the field. We have with us Mr. Bert Rijk, who is the CEO and founder of a company called Aurea Imaging. We have with us Mr. Ilian Schouten from a company called Stekete. We have with us Mr. Jochen Hemming, that you already saw on the video. He's a senior researcher, computer vision and robotics in Wageningen University and Research Center. And we have with us Mr. Peter van der Vlucht, who is the general manager of Kubota. And that includes also the Kubota Innovation Center Europe. Of course, not an unknown company in Japan. So, but anyway, welcome to the four of you. We discussed the challenges of indoor growing and robotics this morning. Outdoor must be a very different game. Mr. Rijk.
Yeah, thanks for having us. I think actually it's not that different. And we see that outdoor is quickly catching up to indoors, where there's of course challenges on weather control. The indoors has a lot more controlled environment. But we do see that, for example, the market potential of outdoor is a lot bigger than indoor in terms of the amount of hectares in horticulture. So actually, I think we'll see that rapidly outdoor will catch up to indoor.
Yeah. Because there are some, when I look at Mr. Schouten from Stekete, your company is active in weeding. Mm-hmm. Weeds are not so such a big problem inside. So if the ball game is all outdoor.
Yes, exactly. We do mechanical weeding, exactly. So what we try to do is to weed only with mechanicals and avoid chemicals in this way. And yeah, as long as we do farming, everywhere around the world there are weeds, and that's one of the most biggest challenges of the farmers. Yeah. Of course, they have diseases, but yeah, as well weeds.
Yeah, and Mr. Hemming, I assume also like pests and plagues. The challenges that you face outdoor are incredibly different from or more complex. When it comes
to
this,
I don't think it's so much different, actually. I think the technologies we use to do these kind of things, to detect the pests and diseases or to detect the plants to weed them, they're very similar to the techniques we also use indoors. However, as already said, so outdoors there are some additional challenges with weather, dust, dirt, and so on. So it's maybe even a little bit harder outdoors than indoors to automate.
I would imagine, because and your company Kubota is also very active outside.
Yeah, exactly. We have all kinds of machines like tractors and implements which operate in the field, and that means that our machines execute really the work in the field, meaning we do pest control, we do weeding as well, we do seeding, crop protection, everything. So in order to do so, you need tractor implement combinations to execute the work.
Yeah. Well, we'll take a closer look into the organizations that you work for. We start with Aurea Imaging because we also to introduce your company. We have a very small video that shows exactly what you're doing. We have a look at what Aurea Imaging is about.
Aurea Imaging ontwikkelt digitale tools. We maken gebruik van sensoren en allerlei slimme algoritmes om de optimalisatie van de agrarische sector, vooral de groente- en fruitteelt, om die een hele stap verder te helpen. Een gemiddelde fruitteler in Nederland heeft ongeveer 500.000 fruitbomen op zijn bedrijf staan. En op dit moment worden die allemaal hetzelfde behandeld. Met onze sensoren kunnen we per boom meten, bijvoorbeeld hoeveel bloesem een fruitboom heeft, hoe hard die groeit, wat het vochtgehalte is op een boom, hoeveel appels die heeft aan het eind.
Aurea Imaging gaat ons in de toekomst helpen om steeds meer inzichtelijk te krijgen hoe ons gewas groeit en dus ook hoe de oogst gaat worden. Het is heel belangrijk om te weten dat je voor de oogst ook al weet van ga ik veel plukken, ga ik weinig plukken. En als je dat echt statistisch kan weergeven, dan weet je van oké, ik ga zoveel kilo's plukken. Hier ga ik zoveel kilo's plukken. En dan weet je ook hoeveel mensen je moet inzetten. Daar kun je beter op inspelen.
We zien een groeikrachtkaart van een appelperceel. De zone in het rood die je ziet, daar zit een muizenplaag. Dus daar hebben de muizen de wortels kapot gegeten. Dus die lopen wat achter in de groei. Een teler kan erop inspelen door op juist die plekken extra bemesting toe te dienen om tot een egalere productie te komen.
Samen met onze partners werken we aan nieuwe manieren om bijvoorbeeld gewasbescherming en toediening van inputs te optimaliseren ook. Een voorbeeld is dat we bijvoorbeeld kunnen detecteren waar precies ziekte en plagen zich bevinden. En heel gericht alleen maar die plekken bespuiten waar dat nodig is. En op die manier kunnen we tot 90% besparing op insecticide bijvoorbeeld. En dat is ook voor de biodiversiteit, maar ook voor de natuurlijke bestrijders een groot voordeel.
Als wij op dit moment gebreken in het gewas hebben, dan corrigeren we die handmatig. Dus ik ga op de spuitmachine zitten en ik ga de plekken waarvan ik denk van daar moet wat gebeuren, die ga ik corrigeren. In de toekomst zie ik daar bijvoorbeeld bij een Aurea Imaging, zie ik daar een kans om hun beelden te gebruiken. En zij laden hun data in onze autonome spuitmachine en die gaat dan de taak voor ons uitvoeren.
Dus enerzijds zien we dat Japan met zijn decennia aan kennis over automatisering en technologie uit bijvoorbeeld de automotive industrie, dat die een enorme bijdrage kan leveren om ook automatisering in de agrarische sector te faciliteren. Anderzijds zie je dat Nederlandse bedrijven, bijvoorbeeld met kennisinstellingen en universiteiten zoals Wageningen Universiteit, en ook de hogescholen, maar ook de boeren die hier iedere vierkante meter weten te optimaliseren. Dat de agrarische kennis uit Nederland en de technologische en automatiseringskennis uit Japan, dat we daar gezamenlijk mee een enorme impact kunnen maken op de toekomst van de landbouw.
Ja, Mr. Rijk, dat was een very interesting video. I assume your technology works best when you have the low trees, not the old-fashioned high ones.
Yeah, definitely. Well, we see that most modern style orchards are lower style trees, but that mainly has to do with productivity, but also labor. Picking fruits lower on the tree is just easier. Yeah.
So you're not active in Japan, I believe.
Well, we have a very good partnership with Kubota for the last year and a half, but we're not actually active in Japan yet. That would be very interesting.
Because I can imagine when you have a market that really appreciates, for example, an apple to have the perfect shape and without any bad spots, that it also becomes economically feasible to get technology to pick the right fruits and to look after these fruits.
Yeah, definitely. We see that, of course, cost savings, especially in terms of labor, is very interesting. But we believe that the upside of having more yield, but especially better quality, so more homogeneous sizes, that is an even greater benefit of this sort of technology.
Yeah, I can imagine. And that would be especially attractive for the Japanese market, I would assume.
Definitely, yeah.
So the costs have been a very important matter for our audience. So we noticed in the indoor session. So an individual grower would have to invest a lot to enter with your systems.
Well, actually, we currently provide our services as a service model. So we use a lot of drone imagery, for example. And growers, they don't have to invest in their own drones, but we have a network of service providers, like a sort of Uber for drone operators. And the farmer, they just pay a price per hectare for our services. So there's no need for large investments on that side. There's occasionally a little bit of investment on for example, the machinery. But we see more and more machinery that's ready to do that, those sort of prescription maps straight away.
And also looking towards the future when there's more and more sensors, I think there's big opportunities for service models, for lease systems, those sort of things to keep the investment low and the capital requirement low as well.
That's interesting because we always think of when you talk about innovation, you know, that things go quicker or whatever, but the innovation can also be in a financing model or that you enter into a service agreement.
Yeah, definitely. Of course, agriculture in general is a sector with low margins and high capital requirement. And we see from other industries like the Airbnbs and Ubers of this world, which is more accepted in other industries, that different types of business models are definitely also interesting. So I think the next step after autonomous greenhouses will be autonomous orchards, and perhaps a different type of model would be required there as well.
Yeah, is that something that the other companies at the table are also doing, or do you still need big investments to, for example, your equipment, Mr. Schouten from Steketee, when it comes to weeding? Is it possible to go into a service agreement?
It's definitely possible. The main question is if the farmers, our customers, are willing to. We face a lot of classical thinking. I think it is not only the Netherlands in this case. I think it's global. And I see some of my colleagues here already confirming. And we think a lot about this. We have a very classical distribution model as well. Working with dealerships, working with capital, highly capital goods, let's say that way. And the farmers, they are used to buying them, and they want to own them. But as Mr. Eich is also saying, we are definitely interested in different models because we see it all around us. In consumer business, we see it. And the new generation farmers, definitely in the Netherlands, but I think in Europe and probably in Japan and everywhere in the world, they are thinking probably different.
It's an interesting part because, as I said, when you talk about innovation, you always think about technical things. But I can imagine maybe in Wageningen University, the human being that has to take the decisions, or the human being, the grower as a human being, is he taken into consideration when you start new developments or when you look at the implementation of things?
Sure, we have to take this into consideration because that's, we have to learn from the human because the human grows since centuries, let's say, crops. So of course, when we are looking into modern technologies on dealing with the big data and making intelligence decisions automatically, we first of all have to look in how the human has done this so far, because it has not done so bad. So this is where it all starts. But now we see that all these new technologies give us so much more data that the human itself is often not possible to process that anymore. So then the automatic algorithms give a lot of benefits to do it even better, maybe. Yeah.
Do you think, Mr. van der Vlucht, because you might know best at the table, that when you talk to the Japanese market, to Japanese growers or companies, that it requires extra effort to convince them to use a certain technology?
I would say so, yes. I think in general, like Mr. Schouten said, all over the world, farmers are very conservative. Also in Japan, you see a lot of aging farmers, whereas it's very difficult to get the younger generation to step into farming. Technology can be one means of attracting younger farmers, younger generations into farming again, into managing farms. And for sure, yes, I think that is something where you see a change coming.
Yeah, so the technology and innovation brings more than just, different production, but you attract a whole new generation or different type of growers and producers.
Yeah, exactly. I think there's a change coming with a newer generation, the next generation. You see it also here in Europe. There's other expectations from technology. It has to be easy to use. So the value proposition to end customers is definitely changing. You see the shift coming already. And I think that Rijk mentioned already the collaboration we're doing here in orchard, autonomous orchards with growers. You see the feedback is really into changing different models, different business models, offering services as a service. With machines, this might also come, this change, although we're still facing traditional sales and distribution channels.
Yeah, because you want to react to that. So
yeah. I think it's definitely an interesting point, because it's actually two ways. We see that young farmers are more interested in staying into farming, actually, because there's more technology. We also see the opposite way, that let's say the latest generation that just graduated from IT and technological studies, they could work in the financial world, they could work with where they probably make a lot more money, but they're interested not necessarily or not only in money, but they're also interested in contributing something to the world. And I think as an agriculture, we're also we see that we're more appealing to these younger generations that want things like purpose in their life. So it's also the other way around, by bringing external people into agriculture.
Yeah, and I can imagine that the pandemic might have also, you know, reinforced this development.
Yeah, you know? Yeah, definitely. There's agriculture was relatively less affected, but I think everybody learned to appreciate food and here, especially here in the Netherlands, I know that there's farmers opening up small shops, but also offering tourism activities and really really supported by the Corona pandemic.
Yeah. Well, you can tourism. You know, when people go to an orchard and they expect a romantic apple picking, they might be surprised when they see your equipment doing the work there. But why not? It's only to help the farmers, right? And to produce safe and sustainable food. Yeah. When it comes to sustainability, Mr. Schouten, and there's a lot of to do in the Netherlands, but in many countries, about the use of pesticides, also about some pesticides which have been around for, which have been accepted, if I may say so, for a long time, and then suddenly we get an alternative of automation and robotization to tackle the problem.
Yeah. Well, to my opinion, the interesting thing here in this whole development is that actually very old technology, in our case it's weeding, it is as old as farming. As you just said, as long as people are doing farming, there are weeds. So we know how to weed already since we have to grow food. So it's very old and traditional. But the interesting thing is now that this technology was almost gone, let's say it in that way, by chemicals. You know, in the 60s, chemicals came up and they kept so effective that farmers said, hey, it's easier. Hey? We can grow a lot and use chemicals. And we were not aware of the impact of that. And what you see now is that technology like the AI, camera technology, vision technology, capacity, of course, and all kinds of things make now all technique again very modern. And that is very interesting. So, you know, old technique and old things from the past, they come back again by using new technologies. So it's very fascinating to see that, that tradition is still there. But by the way, also reacting on, I think we should also not forget that still farming is a lot about craftsmanship. Eh? Technology cannot, we speak about young generations, coming people from other businesses. But also this confirms that at the end, it's a good combination of tradition, farming knowledge, and at the end, of course, nice new technology.
Well, I think we should allow the audience to take to get to know your company a little bit better, because also from your company, we have a short video that I think the audience should watch. That's about steak-a-tay. So the next step in weeding might be that the robot does everything, including driving the tractor and things.
Yeah, that's a good point. Actually, this is exactly what it's about. Together, I think all participants here on the table, they are very interested in robotization, making operation autonomous. But we have a clear philosophy in this, that we think before really stepping into operations like weeding, going fully autonomic, we should also not forget the result of the work. You know, to make the machine autonomous, probably that's even today not the most difficult thing. The most difficult thing today is to make the operation intelligent. That means at the end, in our case again, you have to do weeding. And that is what it's about. So the machine has to check if he does a proper job. And this is exactly what the farmer today is doing on the tractor. So we have to copy, I think, the thinking, the intelligence of the farmer, the driver, he who's looking back to his machine and says, hey, the machine is working well or not, yeah. I have to adjust. And this is the next step. This is what our company, but I think more companies, I'm pretty sure, we are working on and thinking about. So it's, yeah, robotization, yes, but we should not forget to do a proper application, because at the end it's about the application. That's the target, not the robot. Yeah. So,
or at least that farmer was looking pretty happy leaning back in his his tractor.
Yeah.
But Mr. Hemming, you wanted to comment on that.
That's exactly actually where research is currently working on. We just started a new European project this year where it's about the smart implements and the smart tractors. Like autonomous driving, that is something I think is even longer existing in agriculture than in the automotive. So driving along a line on the field, that's possible. But to give the feedback from how has the machine done it and how to react on it, this is really the interesting thing. And that will be the next step. So we can maybe weed autonomously. Now we have to check with sensors we have to develop how good the job was done. And then the system can even improve itself. It can learn from itself. And that is, I think, with the future years, we will see a lot of activity on that topic.
Because that's where your products come in, Mr. van der Vlucht, because I saw your tractor that it doesn't, I mean, it might look like a tractor, but in fact, it's a computer on wheels, isn't it?
Yeah, that's the concept tractor. But before I comment on that one, I think the industry has already a long collaboration in the ag industry between tractor and implement manufacturers. So the level of autonomy and automation is already driven by the industry joining forces between the different brands and manufacturers. So for example, the Stekenteen machine could control a tractor by saying, I need to drive a little bit faster or slower. This is already available, and that makes the work of the farmer much more easy. So we call this TIM, tractor implement management, and lots of tractor manufacturers are working on this kind of semi-level of automation already. And that's where you see the operator sitting in his seat, the tractor drives itself, but is controlled by the implement.
Yeah.
So the next level is that these kind of tractors become more and more autonomous. And then you come into the ideas that Kubota has around the concept tractor, which is a full robotic concept vision.
Because are you already active in Japan, Mr. Schouten?
Stekenteen as a company, not, but we are a member of a bigger company, Lemken, and that company is active in Japan. But the company Stekenteen, I think not yet that much. I see some good potential there. Yeah.
And is Lemken active in the fields that we just saw? That kind of
it's more in arable farming. Yes, in arable farming, in seeding, more like also Kubota is doing in the implement side. There, I think we are quite in the same industry or in the same sector. But for Stekenteen, we are still relatively, let's say, European focused. But in this case, farming, outdoor farming is everywhere. But you can think about vegetables, you can think about normal classical row crops, but also soya and so on. Even rice. Rice is also a product where I see potential even for products like us. So. Yeah, I see some, but not only about, let's say, commercial, also in technology. Because I liked one of the quotes, I think, from the previous rounds, where I think Richard said, it's a lot of hard work. We have to do a lot of work. And this is exactly what it's about. It's not in a way, yes, we need clever, intelligent solutions, a lot of thinking, rocket science, but at the end, it's a lot just doing and working together.
Yeah, it working together, but I think, well, like this webinar is meant to see whether there is a benefit from working with Japanese companies to see if we can take innovation further together. And I think, well, many people at the table here, they illustrate the fact that it is very, very well possible because our two countries are at the forefront of such development.
Yeah, maybe also as well other countries, but in this case, I think yes. I think it was also mentioned the Netherlands more agricultural tradition, whatever. A lot of the need to do it because of the use of our land and the Japanese culture. But I think my colleague Peter can comment more. He's working for a Japanese company, but I know them also as well a little bit. And yeah, the technology, the vision which is coming from the Japanese culture, I think, and the target-oriented philosophy, ideas, culture, I think it's a very good combination. Mm. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, because Mr. Hemming, what's for you for say the next 5 years? Where will we be, in your opinion?
In the open field. Yeah. I mean that we heard already a lot of things, and we have seen a lot of videos where the technology is going, and this development will continue, and it even will increase in speed, because we see also the very big tech companies like a Google or Facebook, they're also investing in these kind of technologies. And also the agriculture sector will benefit from that. So for sure, the field of precision farming, where we go down to the plant level or maybe even the plant organ level and only treat the part of the plant that really needs a treatment, that will become reality in a very short time from now. And yeah, where it will end up in 5 years, we don't know. I don't think the human will be completely out of the loop in 5 years from now, certainly not in the open field. There are also safety regulations when it comes to big machines that drive around autonomously. But for sure, technology will help to do, let's say, more production with less input. So this sustainable argument, that is something that is very strong. Yeah.
But for you in your activities in Wageningen, what is your prime objective?
Now, the prime objective is to do more with less. I would say that is one of the slogans we often use, and that is also what we see. And we do more or less with a lot of data. And in order to process this data, we need also a lot of smart algorithms and intelligence.
Yeah, because when you talk about algorithms and intelligent artificial intelligence, your Wageningen, of course, is still an agriculture university, but I noticed so many companies outside of Wageningen, the more like technical universities, and you mentioned already Google and Apple and those big tech companies, but in the technology-driven development or let's say the non-traditional agricultural activities are driven by companies like yours.
I think we see, for example, a big influx of sensor companies coming, for example, from logistics, like robotic warehouses, autonomous driving cars, of course. So there's definitely a big influx of technology from other sectors, which makes this transition quicker and quicker. I do think an old English farmer once told me that in agriculture it's evolution, not revolution. And so I think that maybe bridges also the point that Mr. Schouten made earlier. Of course, it's very good to have clear vision on the horizon, a clear dream where you want to come, but we should also not forget that agriculture is has a huge legacy in terms of traditions, but also attractors. Most farmers they cannot just ditch all of their fleet and go autonomous tractors. So I think it's important that we definitely have a clear vision, but that we take it step by step to also keep our audience and our clients with us on that journey.
Yeah. Now, it's interesting what Kubota has done in that respect, Mr. van der Vlucht. They already mentioned that your concept tractor is more like a computer on wheels. I assume many of our Japanese viewers know exactly what I'm talking about, but for those who do not, I think also we have a short video about what your company is doing, and maybe we should have a look at that. Still, you know, it doesn't answer all my questions, but it does look revolutionary.
Yeah, it certainly is. It's of course a concept study. So this is our vision: what the tractor of the future be like. Already mentioned at the table here by my colleagues, farmers are very conservative, so they will take it step by step. Just launching a tractor with all this technology right now would still need to prove itself. So it's also creating a level of confidence and trust with the farmers. So this is the study we're conducting into technologies, where are we heading on the tractor side. So full autonomy, different drivetrains, electrification or fuel cell technology, embedded sensors that can scan everything in the orchard or on the open field. There can be fully automated combinations from the implement to the tractor. And this can be any size, but we think it will not be the big size tractors anymore. That will reduce to medium or even smaller size combinations that work 24/7 through the field with these kind of concepts.
Yeah. Now, of course, the Netherlands, you know, we are the second largest export of agricultural products. And but we don't really feed the world. I think it's more like our innovation and entrepreneurship that drive this position as a large exporter, but still we are the size of Kyushu in Japan. But still, you have established your innovation center in the Netherlands. So make me happy and tell me why Kubota has chosen the Netherlands to start these activities here.
Well, obviously, first, the Netherlands is a very nice open society. We have been international traders for centuries already. We established the first contact with the Japanese society, I think, back in the 1700s or something like that. So open trading, people society. On the other hand, we're also having the best agricultural university in the world right here in the Netherlands, with a number of other technical universities in the vicinity of 150 kilometers. So we have TU Delft, TU Eindhoven, TU Twente, each with their own distinct technology backgrounds in, for example, software engineering, nanotechnology, and agriculture here in Wageningen. The reason why we have established the Innovation Centers for Kubota here at the campus in Wageningen University is pretty clear, I think, to be close to the research and the scientists, but also to be close to the ecosystem of start life, incubated companies, being close to what's happening when there's new companies developing new technologies in a fast way. And these startups are acting in a very agile and fast way. Look to Aurea Imaging. They can develop in such a fast pace that you want to be really part of that ecosystem. So the reason why Kubota is there is to be collaborating with platforms like Food Valley, StartLife, Startup, and also we saw this morning One Planet and IMEC. Mm-hmm. So if you want to be doing joint research, this is the place to be, and that's also why Kubota is here.
Yeah. I can confirm that we from the research institutes, we have like ongoing research project with all the people at the table here. So there is a lot of interaction between companies and startups and Wageningen University and research, and that's really what we are also looking for, and we would like to make some impact with the science we are doing.
So we had that at the indoor session. We also had a company at the table that established their European activities in the Netherlands, INAHO. Of course, we have there's also a researcher or a liaison officer from the National Agricultural Research Organization from Japan, NARO, is located in Wageningen.
Yes.
Do we have a privileged relation? And of course, Kubota, very active. But do we have a privileged relation with Japan when it comes to research and development?
We have quite a history in doing joint research projects, especially with the NARO Institute. And even Wageningen Research has established a collaborative research agreement with NARO to look to future research projects together, because we really think that if we join activities from both sides, that we can both benefit a lot. And we have a joint project, the TADA project, that was already mentioned, where also Kubota is part of. So there's a lot of interaction going on already in the sector of the let's say, the greenhouse horticulture, but also in the open field.
Yeah, so Japanese participants should realize they are can find a welcoming ground here.
yeah, sure.
Yeah, there's our time is almost up, gentlemen. There's one thing I would like to go into still, is that we had the indoor environment, we had the outdoor environment to discuss. The big challenge, of course, or the big difference with the outdoor growing is the climate. And to what extent can robotization and AI manage the extra challenges that outdoor growing has? I'm thinking of, we had bad weather last week, for example. How can this new technological development help farmers in facing these challenges? Maybe start with you, Mr. Rijk.
Yeah.
You have an idea about this?
Yeah, well, definitely. We do see that that, for example, orchards and other outdoor crops, they also, because of climate change, they do find ways to get more resilient. So, for example, in orchards, there's now more and more orchards that are covered by hail netting to cover them from to cover the fruits from hail. So that's there are ways to find that. I think companies like maybe like Keygene and breeders that are also working on newer varieties that could be more robust. For example, we see influx from insects, pests from southern European countries. That is possible due to climate change. So it is definitely an interesting topic. I think robots definitely have an opportunity to help there by making it easier to manage this sort of variation also within fields. Things like soil maybe overlooked. Mm-hmm. Greenhouses are using substrates which can be watered and fertilized very precisely. We've got groundwater and soil types that can change dramatically within one field. So there's variation outdoor, but definitely information and data science can help to manage that.
And the same goes more or less for you, Mr. Schouten?
Yeah, and I have one additional point thinking about this. I think where AI technology will definitely help us, because we are outdoor, is that we are depending on weather on sometimes short time slots. You know, the weather is good, the weather is bad, and you have to act. And that's the moment where you need capacity. And technology, AI, can help us to increase capacity. And at the end, if we do even a good job and we learn from it, I think we can also better predict and react on what is coming. So, yeah, I think it will help us a lot to increase capacities and also to be more prepared.
And the same goes for you, Mr. van der Vlucht.
Maybe a side note to capacity. Usually capacity is interpreted as larger machines, and you have to be in the field. But larger machines also cause soil compaction, which is also a problem. And now with more peaks in wet and drought situations in the field, this impacts definitely the work. So I come back again to there will be coming a trend that smaller autonomous equipment, fully operational 24/7, is a must in times of climate change, for sure. Other technologies like tracks instead of wheels on tractors, or maybe even a fully autonomous smaller robot that is doing some scouting in the field, doing some soil sampling, etc. Yes, the soil is definitely where it all starts with the growing. So the soil is the basis of the crop quality in the end.
So, Mr. Hemming, last words for you.
Last words for me. Yeah, to just continue that discussion, I mean, why are these tractors now so big and these machines so big? That is because they require a driver, and that is a large part of the costs. So, but if you go to autonomous machines, then you can allow a number of smaller machines that work together. And that makes it also much more robust, because if then one of these machines break down, not the whole fleet is broken down. Yeah. But if one big combine harvester breaks down, then you have really an issue.
Yeah.
So also, from that point of view, this automation can help.
Yeah, because that took us more or less to the end of this session, and there's plenty more to discuss. And I must also say to the audience that if you want to have an idea of the future, you have to look for the flying autonomous fruit picking robots that these people from Kubota are developing, because you think you're reading a comics book when you see that machine doing its work. But gentlemen, thank you very much for sharing your ideas. Thank you very much also for linking to Japan, which I believe could be a very beneficial and good partner for Dutch agriculture. Thank you so much. And I'm sure the audience will know how to connect with you to discuss any bilateral idea that they would have. So thank you very much. And in the meanwhile, we show you a video of another Dutch company or development not represented at the table at this moment. We'll show you a video of a company called Pixel Farming. So we are back again, and as I said at the beginning, this webinar is organized by the Regional Development Agency OostNL, which is the east part of the Netherlands, by the Dutch Enterprise Agency RVO, by the Netherlands Embassy in Tokyo, and by Wageningen University and Research Center.
And you know, in 1600s, we had a ship called the Liefde shipwreck in Kyushu to establish contacts with the Japanese people. Now, things go quite differently. Not a surprise, maybe. But we have two people at the table that really drive the cooperation between the Netherlands and Japan. And we have with us Belkis Askayar and Mr. Bert van der Heijden. But we start with you, Belkis, because can you tell us a little bit what are the objectives of OostNL, the development agency that you work for?
Yes, thank you, Frederik. Well, I present the Economic Regional Development Agency, OostNL, for the eastern part of the Netherlands. And we support companies on many different topics, such as business development, fundings, investments. And we also assist foreign companies who are interested in doing business in the Netherlands, in our region especially. For example, Kubota, who has her European office set up close to the University of Wageningen. What we call in the middle of Food Valley. And I myself am part of the trade development team. And our goal is to assist companies who are willing to expand their business abroad by trading and working close with the international companies. And like I mentioned, yeah, in our region, the renowned University of Wageningen is also located with many food companies, such as the Unilever's International R&D and many innovative start and scale-up companies.
Yeah, and you have, and I know you're very active from experience, but you have especially you're setting up activities for Japan, is that right?
Yes, that's correct. We noticed that many smart agriculture companies have a huge interest in the innovation and developments in Japan and are eager to look for opportunities to collaborate. Yeah, well, Japan and the Netherlands, we know, face many similar challenges, such as an aging population and increased labor scarcity. So in those elements, we complement each other very well. And our next step is to form a trade mission to Japan with a select group of companies, Dutch companies who are active in the smart agriculture. And we offer them a tailor-made matchmaking program. We will work together with a professional Japanese consultant who will set up business appointments specific for each company individually based on their requested profile of a Japanese partner for collaboration. So if there are any Dutch companies who are interested in working together with Japan and to expand the trade relations, please contact us to discuss this opportunity further. And of course, we're also very interested to getting to know the Japanese organizations and companies who are then interested in working with the Netherlands. You can contact us from OostNL, our partners at RVO, or the Dutch Embassy in Tokyo, who's also great in supporting.
Thank you very much, because I really think this webinar is a good illustration of the opportunities that there are for collaboration between Japan and the Netherlands. So I do hope that when it is possible to visit again Japan with a trade mission, that we can meet all those people that are now behind a screen looking at this webinar. We also have at the table a representative of the Netherlands Enterprise Agency, Mr. Bert van der Heijden. Bert, because also the Netherlands Enterprise Agency supports entrepreneurs and knowledge institutes in establishing collaborations in business and innovation. And you've often worked with, you know, agencies like OostNL. So from your perspective, what is your, how do you see our collaboration with Japan?
Yeah, correct. Thanks for this introduction. I'm specifically working in international innovation, on international innovation programs in the agri-food domain. And for us, also, Japan is a priority country, specifically when it comes to developing smart agriculture applications and technologies. So developing innovative AI and robotic applications. And this is where we see a great complementarity also with Japan. We already heard this morning several examples of Dutch-Japanese collaborations. Kubota was here, Inaho, but also the collaboration between Denso and Certon in the greenhouse sector. So these are all very nice examples and illustrations of the possibilities, but we feel there's much more to get really the robots into the greenhouse and on the land commercially. Yeah.
So you in relation to Japan, do you have any activities planned to increase the relationship?
Yeah, definitely. We are planning at the end of this year, we hope to travel to Japan for a innovation mission. And we really want to combine the strength of the Japanese high-tech and expertise in automation with the Dutch horticulture and open field agriculture domain knowledge to really accelerate and I would say advance innovation in this field. In such a mission, we would be looking for really committed partners on both sides, companies and knowledge institutes that really want to tackle these challenges with technology. This could result in different types of collaboration. It could be more the one-on-one types of collaboration like Denso and Certon, for instance, but also more in consortia like the TADA project, which was mentioned also this morning, I believe. More public-private partnerships with both industry and knowledge institutes that can also be funded by the Dutch top sectors, for instance. So there's different possibilities which we would like to explore, and I think there's a lot that our both countries can do together.
Yeah, thank you so much. I think for the audience, there might be a QR code somewhere along this program in your screen, which you, by scanning, here it is. By scanning, you get additional information about the missions and the economic missions that we are organizing, and how to get in touch with the organizers and to get engaged with the participants also today of the seminar. So thank you very much for sharing your ideas and your plans with us and the audience. And then, ladies and gentlemen, we turn to someone else who is making whose job it is to create a bridge between the Netherlands and Japan in the field of agriculture. My good friend and colleague Evert-Jan Kraaienbrink is with us. He's the agricultural counselor at the Netherlands Embassy in Tokyo. And the famous last words from this webinar will come from him. Evert-Jan, great to see you again. We happily give you the floor for your closing remarks.
Yeah, thank you so much, Frederik, for giving me the floor. You know how it is to be an agriculture counselor, as you also was one in Tokyo for many years ago. Good morning to you. It's getting dark in Tokyo, and it's for me a great honor to do the closing remarks. The last few years, I was really active with our team to promoting and the smart agriculture. And for me, it was really interesting to see all the presentations which came along today. This virtual company tour was in a way the follow-up of the digitalization mission of this February, where many companies participated in our mission of Vice Minister Mona Keijzer. And this opportunity of organizing a new event at the Ranka Good Now and the organized by the Team NL Tokyo Expert platform is a great opportunity to present practical examples of applied research technology, what is already available now and in the near future. Technology that is that can be used by Farmer de Jong, as Mr. Ambassador was saying in his welcome word. And I think we really hit on something, because there was a massive interest in participating in this event. Many, many more, almost 600 participants signed up. And it's amazing, you know, it shows how actual the topic is. Also here in Japan, where the government recently has announced, and I have to read it aloud, the measure for the achievement of decarbonization and resilience with innovations. And that's a strategy with ambitious goals towards a more sustainable food system. And I want to mention a few of the ambitions. They want to realize zero emissions in 2050, 30% less fertilizers, 50% less pesticides, And these are ambitious goals, which they want, we want to realize, and also Japan want to realize by innovations. And we've seen today really inspiring examples of entrepreneurs and companies who are providing solutions for these challenges. In the first part of the program, we focused on robotics and especially the key enabling technologies around it, the current status. And the ISO group showed examples of Japanese robots provided by Denso performing horticulture operations. Speakers from Yuan Planet and Demcon discussed the technology developments, which are now making robotics possible. And it's clear that there is a trend towards more robotizations. And one of the speakers and also the presentations afterwards said that in 3 to 5 years, there will be many robots in horticulture. And in 10 to 15 years, there will be the autonomous greenhouse. And that was also the topic of the second part of the program, where we focused on IA and robotization and digitalization indoor in greenhouses. We saw interesting examples of the Wageningen University, Keychain, Kind Technologies, Hortilux, Hogendoorn, and Enau. We're all working with harvesting robots, data-driven procedures, and the automation of the post-harvest operations. Now, it's not a question when the autonomous greenhouse will take place. It will be really in the near future. And that is something, everyone is working very hard for. Thirdly, the third part of the program, we looked at the developments of the open field agriculture, which is what became clear, more difficult than indoor. You have the climate circumstances, diseases, dirt. So there are more challenges. And we saw really interesting examples of pixel farming, array imaging, Stekete, again, the Wageningen, played a very important role in all our innovations, and Kubota. And it's interesting to see how many of these increasing digitalizations on farms are already taking place in the solutions. Also, new developments are in the development of business models to make it more affordable for the farmers. So I hope you all enjoyed the program. As explained by RVO and OCNL, there will be a follow-up with a follow-up mission and to establish public-private partnerships or trade relations. It's a great follow-up because after the corona periods, we want to see each other again and really would like to bring these parties together. This brings me to the end of my concluding remarks. Let me finish by showing gratitude to all of the speakers, the translators, and of course to you, Frederik, for being a moderator. Arigato gozaimashita.
Thank you very much, Evert-Jan, thank you. Well, yes, ladies and gentlemen, that brings us to the end of our program. I hope you enjoyed it. I want to thank all the speakers and I want to thank you as an audience. In about 1 month from now, the Olympics will start. There's not a gold medal for horticulture, but otherwise the Netherlands would have been a clear contestant. More important even is good health. And I think by good health can also be reached by eating healthy. So that brings us back to horticulture again. But anyway, I stay safe, stay healthy. And again, we hope to see you in person really soon. Thank you so much. And there's another small video about the Dutch philosophy in farming coming after my last words. But again, as I said, thank you very much. See you soon. Stay safe. Thank you.